So the question is really what defines Bitcoin's stock to flow, and Manuel did the black box approach. So he was looking at treating Bitcoin like a black box and only looking at the output, the Bitcoin blockchain. So he mentioned you need a full node. You can get all the data from the Bitcoin network. Don't have to download it from somewhere. You get it on your own full node. And you look at what comes out. It's the blockchain. And another approach in engineering or reverse engineering is the white box approach, that you don't look at the input and the output, but you just look at the inside of the engine. And I would like to do this little experiment with you and help you doing this, or showing you that it's not so difficult. So there's many ways to do this. One approach is to look at the source code, which is on GitHub. I think not everybody heard of GitHub, or probably not everybody here ever used it. So I will give you a bit of a feeling how it looks like. So lots of very functional. That's why I hide or I blend it and only show you the important parts. So actually GitHub is like a Facebook for developers, where people can meet and exchange, instead of cat videos, they exchange software code. And one interesting thing about the Bitcoin project on GitHub is it has 678 contributors right now. That's people contributing to the code base of Bitcoin Core. Not the whole Bitcoin ecosystem, because there are many other Bitcoin implementations, but this is the main one, Bitcoin Core. So just for a comparison, when WhatsApp sold to Facebook, they were like a 50 people company, but probably 10 developers serving around 1 billion users. Bitcoin Core has a significant amount of contributors. The other one is the license. It's under the MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology license, which is the most open license, which means you can do anything with this code base, no patents. You just have to mention who you used that code from. Another thing interesting is the number of watchers on this project. So whenever somebody changes a single line of code in this main project, 3,500 people get an email about, they are notified about that change, so they can watch it, inspect it. And we have around 25,000 forks of the software already. This doesn't mean that every of these forks is a cryptocurrency we can see in the wild. Yeah? I can fork it, and then I have my own code base to play with just under my account. But it's a very popular project, and many cryptocurrencies are mainly Bitcoin code with a few modifications. Okay, so this tool, GitHub, allows you to dive into the source code. And what I would like to show you is there's a file validation. Where's the validation happen? And if you scroll there in line 2200, there's, don't get scared, yeah? I know not many are here a developer, that's why I make it really easy. But there's a function, it's called get block subsidy. And this function is executed every time there's a new block, and the block needs to be validated. If the amount of Bitcoin new Bitcoin introduced is valid. And here's the first the halvings is calculated, so that's what Manuel mentioned. That it takes the current height. So today I looked it up, we are at 600,007 something. Yeah, that's the block number. So there have been about more than 600,000 blocks found already and validated. And it's divided by the called subsidy halving interval. So what is it? There's another file, it's called chain parameters. Hide the not so important things. And there you can see it. Yeah, the subsidy halving interval for the Bitcoin mainnet is defined as 200,000. So every 200,000 blocks, Bitcoin is a new epoch, in a new era. Yeah? In the beginning, when the height was 1 divided by 210,000 is 0, if you round it to an integer number. Yeah? So in the beginning, there was no halving epoch. But since we are in 600,000 now, we are in the second halving epoch. And this is the subsidy, which is allowed. So it's 50. multiplied with coin. Coin is defined as 100 million. I don't show this here. So one Bitcoin is 5 billion. 50 Bitcoin is 5 billion Satoshi. 50 times 100 million. But since we calculated the halvings before, it's a bit weird operator in C++. It's called the right bit shift. You could also write the same line as we divide the subsidy, the 50 Bitcoin, by the halvings multiplied with 2. So we halve the new subsidy with every halving epoch. It's just, you would get a problem with a division by zero in the first epoch. That's why this is a very geeky but more convenient line to explain or to write this. Yeah, and then what's the last thing for the stock to flow is we have the 10 minutes Manuel mentioned. So here it's in seconds, 10 times 60. That's the target for the space, the time space between the blocks should be 10 minutes. And the difficulty is adjusted every 2 weeks, which if you divide the time span by the spacing, you get to every 2016 blocks, the difficulty is difficulty in Bitcoin should be adjusted either up or down. What I want to show you with this exercise that Bitcoin almost doesn't deserve the word cryptocurrency, because in the monetary definition, how much money should exist, it's high school math, or even maybe every 10-year-old who has some basic reading and computer knowledge can start looking into this. And so it's not like people have to think Bitcoin is this magic high cryptography internet money where only a few people can understand it and validate it. Whenever there's a new Bitcoin release, for instance, we in our company, we don't download the binaries or the machine code which is provided by that project. You can do that in GitHub, but we download the soft code and just look at the differences to the previous version and compile the Bitcoin software for our own. Takes a few minutes, half an hour, depending on your machine, but there's no need to trust somebody who develops this code, and future generations who learn like basic programming, like language, like we learn a foreign language, they can see that and verify for themselves what the code is. But what guarantees that this code isn't changed? So we figured out, okay, stock to flow worked until now, according to the model, because the model is actually programmed into the code. It's not like we discovered something, we just verified, as Manuel mentioned, that the stock to flow in reality is like it's programmed, and for some reason the market price or market cap is following that. So Bitcoin has over 100,000, we call them first class citizens. That's people who run that code I just showed you for themselves at home, at work, on their computers. And actually anybody can change the code. But what happens is that you create like a new species. Yeah? I can change the code, you can change the code after I showed you where to find it. And that's actually exactly what happened in the last 11 years, that a lot of different forks or trials of Bitcoin were created. But whenever you create a new child of Bitcoin, it's a single fish which is out there alone. And nobody from the Bitcoin fish farm will talk to that child. So Bitcoin is a technology where you can change the code, but you can only change or fork yourself off the network, but you cannot force everybody else in the network to accept your change or force people into that change, because everybody has the software under their own control and doesn't need to follow you. So, but this would mean that any cryptocurrency which is modeled after a certain stock to flow schedule and released as a cryptocurrency should follow the market cap should follow that. The question is, we see it right now only with Bitcoin, and what makes sure that in the future the market really keeps following Bitcoin and not tomorrow another cryptocurrency or in a year? Yeah? So here are the top 2,400 coins. And what we can see is that from all the coins, so probably Manuel, you only did it for Litecoin, but none of the other coins, and I guess there are many who have like a similar algorithm like Bitcoin in there, they are not following the Bitcoin performance. They are all trending either to zero or to stabilizing, as Manuel mentioned it, to the Bitcoin value. So the black one is Bitcoin, and then you have the plot of all the other ones. And Litecoin is probably, it was created in 2013 or 11, I think. Probably, it could be named, probably the yellow one is Litecoin. So that's the reality. And this is conclusion I come with, is that technology doesn't matter for cryptocurrencies. The parameters don't matter. The throughput doesn't matter because there are many cryptocurrencies who said we have higher throughput, more velocity, more transactions. Is not driving the value, even convenience, yeah? Because many projects say, okay, Bitcoin is the first one, but we know how to make it nicer. Talking about the adoption, yeah, that we have the better user interface, more convenience for the user. All of this doesn't seem to matter. And we figured out that Bitcoin has eight unique properties where it is the leader in all of these areas. So I cannot talk about them in detail now. This would take a bit quite a bit longer. Regarding the openness, I gave you an example in the beginning that everybody can look in the code. It's not super complicated. Anybody can join the Bitcoin network. Anywhere in the world. It's the borderless characteristic. It's a decentralized project. There's no leader. Even Bitcoin Core is not the leader defining the path of the project. It's a distributed network where every node has the same roles as all the others. It's a permissionless network. You don't need to ask anybody for permission to change it or to innovate on it, to join it. It has censorship resistance properties. And what you will realize after a few years in this space is everybody writes this into their white paper, that they have these properties, but only the green ones here, openness, borderless, distributed, can be a design choice. So you can design your cryptocurrency to be open, or you can design it, okay, I want it to be closed. I want it to be borderless, or I want it to be it valid only within my country. You can design it to be distributed or centralized. Yeah? Even permissionless, you can say I can introduce KYC mechanisms to my cryptocurrencies or not. And censorship resistance, I can also implement something like blacklisting, whatever. But the other properties like decentralization, immutable, and trustless are spontaneous emerging properties. So you can copy Bitcoin, but you won't copy these eight properties. Maybe the first one, but then you will have a lot greater weakness on trustlessness, immutability, and decentralization. And I explain this that Bitcoin has something like a firewall, and that's the time and energy that goes into the network to protect it. So we can see this in numbers. The Bitcoin hash rate, so the mining power, is at around 100 exahash per second right now. And you can imagine this like a deflector shield in Star Trek, that you need to have at least, an attacker would have to have at least the energy of the force field which protects the Bitcoin network to attack it. And this is not something you can design in the code. It has nothing to do with the code. So here we can see this in another number, that time multiplied with energy. Right now, it would take 400 days, the computing power of the Bitcoin network, if the Bitcoin network would stop doing what it does and try to rewrite the blockchain, it would take 400 days to do this. But of course, if an attacker even if it has the same amount of energy available and the hardware. So it's not only the energy, but you also need the mining chips, which have a stock to flow in the production of the mining chip factories. It would take the attacker 400 days to get to the point where Bitcoin is now, but Bitcoin keeps doing for 400 days and is already 400 days ahead again. So you would probably need at least twice the energy and computing power Bitcoin consumes right now to attack the network. And think of the other fork of Bitcoin. Here's Bitcoin Cash, which has only a resistance of like, I think it's 37 days right now. So with the other cryptocurrencies, you always have the risk that the Bitcoin network could, if they wanted, if they had an interest, spend a few resources to attack weaker networks. And this is what greatly contributes to the immutability and trustlessness, that everybody who sees these numbers says, okay, Bitcoin is really, really hard to attack. And with all the other networks, they have a weaker protection because there is no real immutability in the universe. So everything is immutable, even our sun, which we think we cannot destroy, but someday in a few million years it will be gone. So in our universe, there is nothing like that. But practical immutability for us humans is only defined and the maximum by the Bitcoin network. And if you make a sacrifice on any of these eight properties, the other ones will collapse. So this 21 million market cap, there will be never more than 21 million. The most credible network which can fulfill this promise is the Bitcoin network. So we can, in terms of stock to flow, or interesting for stock to flow, we can categorize two types of digital currencies. So one are sound money, I would call Litecoin as well as Bitcoin. Into this area, maybe something like Monero. So you can do the white box analysis and you see in the code, okay, it has sound money properties. And you have easy money, maybe something like Ethereum, which doesn't have a cap. And whenever they should make it more difficult to print more money, then there's a call. And if six developers say, no, we delay the difficulty bump, then as happened last week or 2 weeks ago, then you see there's politics involved, which can, it doesn't matter what's written in the code, if a consortium of a few people can decide, okay, we don't make it harder to print money like with Bitcoin. So this is the difference, yeah? Make printing money hard or ideally impossible. And easy money is mainly to enrich the founders or the weird economic concepts behind these cryptocurrencies. And there you can see stock to flow is completely irrelevant for easy money. So if you're interested in easy money, why do you even care about stock to flow? The idea is to have flexibility. With sound money, it reduces the uncertainty about what Mania mentioned, the future stock to flow. Yeah. Easy money increases the uncertainty about future stock to flow. So we only need to look into the candidates in the sound money area. And there the question is, yeah, it's clear that maybe something like Litecoin or something like Ethereum doesn't follow stock to flow. Maybe something, even something like Ripple. Yeah, there were 100 billion tokens creating in the beginning. There is no stock. There is no flow. Yeah, the stock is there from the beginning, but it was easy to print. Somebody just hit enter, and then there were 100 billion tokens. But the market doesn't care, because what's uncertain is the entity who has the majority of this token, in which frequency they will be releasing it to the market. So you can imagine Bitcoin like a supermassive monetary gravitation object. Within the area of sound monies, only the hardest one will probably be able to reflect the stock to flow value in the market capitalization. And I explained that if the value of Bitcoin would be below the stock to flow, then somebody would realize and exploit that possibility that the value is too low and move money from the easier commodities into that one. And if it's something like in 2017 happens, when the price overshoots the model value too much, the reason is that you can never consider money in isolation, but also always within an economy. And if something like in 2017 happens, then the prices for the existing Bitcoin holders for products will be relatively cheap because their money appreciated so much that their time preference kicks in and purchasing decisions they had planned for the future can be fulfilled now, which will bring back the price of to the value where it's reasonable. So money is special in terms of all the goods and services in the economy that there can never be a shortage of money. Yeah? Any amount of money is always enough, not like with a car that production was planned too low and nobody can get a new car and has to wait for 3 or 5 years. With money, you will always find somebody who is willing to sell. You just have to offer more if there's a higher demand. So you can imagine Bitcoin like this black hole which is sucking value according to the stock-to-flow, like we have in physics, the gravitational constant sucking from other monies in its vicinity. And since Bitcoin is borderless and globally everywhere, then it's sucking value from all commodities which have a monetary premium in them right now, according to the stock-to-flow model. So the only thing I see what can happen is that Bitcoin explodes from within in the future. Yeah, that's something within the network which doesn't work forever or not as we think now. But to cover against that, you just have to learn Bitcoin and understand it. Because then something like in 2017 when there was a split, like two monies almost identical, Bitcoin Cash only changed a little parameter, increasing the block size from 1 megabyte to 4 or 8, don't remember anymore what they wanted to increase it to. It would have looked completely identical from sound money properties. But if you understood Bitcoin, that with increasing the block size, you would immediately lose 80% of the network because there are very old computers within this 100,000 nodes that do the validation. The decentralization property of Bitcoin would have been reduced greatly, which would risk the promise of the fixed market cap. And this is something, if you know Bitcoin, if you learn Bitcoin, you can anticipate or foresee in the future when something like this happens again, which one will probably be the best decision for the network to move forward. So I can only encourage you to learn Bitcoin, really, and it's worth it. The next opportunity will be this Saturday, so if you have interest, we have a few slots available. It's just 6 hours of your life to get into this path of becoming a Bitcoin citizen. Yeah.